disconnected, and that we can no longer separate the importance and the value of the Arctic from the sustainable growth of economies around the world. I have worked on this issue for a number of years now and pioneered the work on connecting climate change to human rights. And I really do believe it is through the power of human rights approach that we can move the discussion out of the realm of dry economic and technical debate that so often overtakes discussions at so many levels. And so a human rights approach, I think, takes that path of principle. It shows us that the fundamental change is not just sound policy, but it is an ethical imperative. And I've seen the power of this approach at work in my global work that I have done for many years now in linking climate change to human rights, and how the Arctic climate change is all about the environmental, cultural, and human rights. And I saw how the world really became very enthusiastic about that connection and welcomed our work. You know, for years now, as I say, it has been an issue that most people have tended to give to the responsibility of politicians and economists and scientists. But in reality, this issue belongs to all of us. And why have people felt so enthusiastic about this work? I think because people can relate to the issue when we bring it to that human dimension. We can all understand that when it comes down to us interpreting all of these issues about it being with our children and grandchildren and our families in the communities. So in the international arenas where I've personally been involved, the language of economics and technology are always going to be calling for further delay. You know, we make headway in the global arena on these issues, you know, as we negotiate these large global treaties, and then we take several steps backwards at each session of these negotiations that are ongoing. And there's always something that somehow comes up in the forefront of this work that then sidelines or sidetracks our issues on that human scale and that human level. And so we're constantly reminded how greenhouse emissions will impact our economy, and it becomes the excuse for not addressing the issue. However, I think if we continue to and move in the direction of and really understand and appreciate that reframing the debate of this issue in terms of fundamental human rights and the connections between environmental change and cultural rights refocuses the debate on humanity and not just economy. And I think that's where we need to continue to focus. And I believe that if we must reframe the terms of debate over climate action in that way. Because this approach of focusing climate change solely to economics tends to silo the important issues or separate the issues from one another, as opposed to recognizing the connections between rights, environment, health, economies, and society. I can't see the pictures behind me, so there's a couple of them that I really want to point out to you, and as I often do in the talks that I give. But so pardon me as I turn my head every once in a while here. So defending the right to be cold, the Inuit right to be cold, is about connectivity. It really is. And that we're all very connected by this fundamental human right. A right which requires all of Canada to focus and the attention and care in defending that right, because that right for us to be cold is related to all of us in this room and beyond, in our right to have a healthy environment for our children and grandchildren. And so we must continue to keep the pressure on our own leaders and governments to ensure that That's my grandson. Oh, yes, of course you would recognize him. And so it's my grandson. He was on a boat hunting with his father at the time. And that's Mr. Lee, my grandson, who's now almost 20. Imagine this. I have a four-year-old, a grandson as well, Inuapik, who is now a wonderful part of our family. So I have two grandsons that are living in the Arctic. So now that I've spoken to you, in a sense, on the heady parts of the work that I do, I'm going to move in the direction of the heart of the matter, because that's who I am. That's what I do, is to connect with you as human beings, as I did today. And I must say I was very touched by the lunch I had today with the students at this university, because it is through that kind of connection and the hope that I've been given and inspired by what this university is doing, but by that generation and what they're doing, and that they get it. They get it right away. They don't have to be convinced of anything, and that they are the change agents that are coming up. So watch out for us, our generation, because they are going to make that impact on what is happening to our planet without even thinking twice about it. They're already there. And so that lunch today just gave me lots of hope again, as it does when I speak with the younger generations across this country. And I was very moved by it and very inspired and very fed very deeply by that lunch today. So thank you, if any of you are here, for that today. So I wrote the book, The Right to Be Cold, for a number of reasons. But one of them, really, one of the big reasons was, you know, we have heard and we hear on TV, on radio, everywhere you go, the struggles and the challenges that our communities face at the family and community level. In the Inuit world, we are known to have the highest suicide rates in North America. This has not been the reality for us until it's a recent phenomenon. I was 18 when we had the first suicide in my community. Many things have been happening, and I wanted to write the book to be able to share, from my perspective, the historical context to the issues that we face and the challenges we face in terms of the social health, the poverty, the hunger, the suicides, all of the historical traumas that have come in our country, which many Canadians do not know anything about. I taught at Mount Allison University after I had been a year in Maine at Bowdoin College, and I wondered if our Canadian kids would fare better than the American kids that I had been teaching the year before in terms of understanding that history, only to realize that our Canadian students did not have any of that history taught to them throughout their lives either. And so I realized there was much that we needed to do in terms of educating that generation in particular to better understand the context of the challenges that we face in our communities, so that we can move beyond by understanding and feeling a sense of understanding and compassion to the struggles that we face in our Aboriginal communities. I also wanted to share my own journey throughout this process and to steal a line from Maya Angelou and say that many people have gotten to know my glory over the years because of the accolades and the recognition I've received for my work, but many didn't know my story. And so it was important to share that, not just for Canadians to understand that context of where we're coming from as a people collectively, but for the younger generation from my own communities to better understand the context we're coming from, so that they can perhaps better take off a little bit of that load and burden that they carry from the historical traumas that have been passed down and the woundings that have continued in our communities. And so I was born in Kudjuak, a small community, a Hudson's Bay Company post across the river, and lived very traditionally and traveled only by dog team the first 10 years of my life. And I didn't know any English until I was 6 years of age when I started school. And we lived a very close-knit culture where everything mattered and everything was connected. And as I said in some of the talks I've been giving in the TED Talk, it was kind of like a magic from where I was coming from. And then we've come from that ice age to the space age, really, in this world, in one lifetime, in one generation. And there have been a lot of those historical traumas along the way. And so issues such as climate change and food insecurity and the suicides are major concerns, but it wasn't always that way. In fact, I remember a time it wasn't that way. And so for us, hunting, again, not a lot of people understand that connection of the power of the hunting culture is not a sport. Along with the technical aspect of the hunt, where our children are taught, as I said earlier, to be taught to be proficient providers and natural conservationists and efficient seamstresses, the process of the hunt itself is very powerful in teaching, as I say, the life and character skills. And what I mean by that is, as you're waiting for the snow to fall, the ice to form, the winds to die, the weather to improve, the animals to surface, you are being taught patience. You are being taught endurance, persistence, courage, resiliency, and you are ultimately being taught sound judgment and wisdom. And these skills that one is taught on that ice and the cold and the snow are extremely transferable to the modern world. And in fact, they are a requirement for this generation who's been through much to be able to overcome the obstacles that are now upon us. And with all of the changes that are happening to our environment and our climate, our ability to pass down these powerful teachings that allow our children to make life-affirming choices rather than life-taking choices, these teachings are being minimized when institutional schooling has all but eliminated those necessary skills. And so I've learned through the many talks that I have given across the country that very few people in our own country, very few Canadians, understand or even heard of many of these historical traumas that many of our communities have endured. And some, starting with the forced relocations to the high Arctic in the 60s in the name of sovereignty, the collapse of the sealskin market in the 60s, which really stripped away the dignity of our hunters to provide for their families. Children separated from their families to be sent away to far off places for school. I was one of those children at the age of 10, where I spent 2 years in Nova Scotia, 3 years in residential school, and 3 years here in Ottawa. Culture suppression, and of course oppression, has diminished and really did damage our sense of identity and our sense of self-worth and the control over our lives. And so the addictions that you see and the violence are symptoms of those traumas endured. As I said, the first suicide in my community was when I was 18. And so we have come to be in this place where we're starting to piece these historical contexts together to better understand why we have come from such a powerful, resilient, ingenious culture that had our own independent systems in place, to one now to being really highly dependent on substances, processes, institutions. And we've started to piece these this history together. And so here we are, really, from the first wave of tumultuous changes and understanding those pieces and coming to recognize the root of the breakdown of our society, only to realize yet there is another wave of tumultuous change upon us. The very thing that we feel is going to put us back on solid ice, pun intended, is now starting to melt away. And when the climatic changes start to impact the Arctic ice, it makes it much more precarious. It brings on more stressors in an already stressed situation because the ice is very much a big part of our identity. It is our highways. It is our life force. And it is something we have known to be as permanent as your rivers and your mountains. And one has to remember that ice for us is mobility and transportation. And when it becomes precarious, it immediately becomes an issue of safety and security. And so the climatic changes that we're faced with only have added much more stress and anxiety to a community with that historical context of trauma. So it isn't just about the polar bears. This isn't just about the ice itself, but about people and families who are truly trying to make it in this new world order of globalization that has hit us in one lifetime, where most societies have taken 350 years to adjust and adapt from the hunter-gatherer fisher society. And I'm also reminded, being a Canadian, of the times recently even where when disasters strike in our country, for example, the floods now around this area, the wildfires last year in the West, there's always a form of outpouring of support, which is great to see that kind of support and generosity that Canadians can just be so good at. But imagine in our Aboriginal communities of this country, where the equivalent level of emergency has been there every single day for decades now, where you feel a loss, a sense of loss of what is happening around you. Because imagine how many Aboriginal communities in this country are still without clean drinking water. We're in Canada here. Not for a week, a month, a year, but for decades. Imagine for us in the 80s, in the work that Stephanie and I did globally, Inuit being poisoned from afar, from toxins making their way up through the weather patterns into our food chains, into the blood cord, and the nursing milk of Inuit women, where we became the net recipients of these toxins as a result of industry or the byproduct of industry, pesticides from everywhere else. And making this issue a health issue rather than a chemical story that it was in the beginning, and putting this as a real urgent health matter for us in the Arctic. Imagine women going missing with no explanation for decades in your communities. Imagine that your children in the constant worry because of the epidemic of suicides in our communities, the worry that parents and grandparents go through on a daily basis because of that high risk of self-destruction that is happening due to the intergenerational legacies of trauma and the structural racism that still exists in our institutions, which make you feel less than who you are meant to be, day in, day out. What if that constant state of emergency became the new normal? What kind of psychological impact might that have on your community? But that's what's happened in the historical context of our communities. It is not because we are weak. It is not because we don't have the ability to adapt. In fact, we are the most adaptable people in the world, I would think, because of the environment we live in. We are, after all, the remarkable people who invented the kayak, the boat that is replicated worldwide. We are the people who can build a home of snow warm enough for your children and babies to be in and your women to give birth to their babies in. We have the ingenuity, we have the wisdom, we have what it takes to be able to contribute and survive. But the speed in which changes have happened in the Arctic and the traumas that have happened have really kept our spirits low and in fact have dispirited many of us. And so we have to start to think in terms of how the Aboriginal communities and the traumas that have been inflicted upon us and how we are reacting irrationally, unpredictably, just as a child that has been through trauma without the help and the intervention is acting, so too is our planet in the same way that we are bringing trauma to it. And so we have to start to think about that kind of strong connection with our planet and with the Aboriginal communities, because for me, the understanding is that they are one of the same, based from a lot of arrogance, a lot of what Alex has described as stupidity, all of those things, but we're not that. We are not only that. We as Canadians can come together to better understand and how we can start to move ahead in really truly the issues and address the issues of reconciliation. So what we're seeing in our communities, what you hear and read about, and in our atmosphere are in fact not abnormal behaviors. What we are seeing are perfectly normal reactions to extremely abnormal circumstances at the human level and at the planetary level. And so climate change, yes, is happening, but it isn't just an environmental issue. It is affecting everyone at the human level, because if we keep Inuit hunters on the ground, hunting, fishing, gathering, we not only will be the sentinels for the planet, but we will be the guardians, not just for our own culture, but for the rest of the planet. So the world has a vested interest in keeping us in a cold environment and supporting that right to be cold for us in the Arctic. Because the right to be cold and thrive, as we have, is connected to everyone's right to a healthy environment. And we need to come together to address these challenges now, otherwise where will it end? And so I'm not speaking to be pessimistic, because I wouldn't be standing in front of you sharing this story if I didn't have hope. And I see it everywhere I go, that hope. And I see it in the younger generation, as I did today with the lunch that I had. But you know, we can't think our way through these crises anymore. We have to, we've tried politics. I don't think the movement is really going to be in politics. Not that I'm trying to be not hopeful about political leadership, but I don't think it's really going to be there. I think it's going to be in all of us who decide and understand better these kinds of connections and where we can move ahead in making it work for us. We need to reassure society that change will not punish our economy, but rather, I think, provide an opportunity to flourish in the future, creating a better world. And I think if we do really want to reconcile, we do have to not just think our way through, but feel our way through and discover what really matters. And as I said, discover, I think, again, that connection to nature. Because I think it's that, and I heard this before, and it rung through for, really true for me, it is as a result of the nature deficit disorder that urban settings are now, not connected to each other, not connected to their food source, not connected to nature and what's happening, that we are even debating this issue of climate change in the first place. And so I think we need to reconnect and have that true connection back to not just to nature, but to each other, to the Aboriginal communities that really do have a place, a rightful place, to contribute and educate on what sustainability really means. And so we can counter, I think, the causes and effects of trauma in our Aboriginal communities, as well as our climate that is now in trauma. And so there's much more to do, there's no doubt. We have many situations that we still are dealing with, even in this day and age, as I say, in our communities, in terms of the health issues. Many of you, if you heard Recently, a 15-year-old died of tuberculosis in one of our communities. We're in 2017 here, and we're in Canada, and yet this can still happen. A young mother, or an older mother now actually, who finally found her daughter after 50 years, where in the days when people were sent away for tuberculosis and other health problems, never to return, and were buried somewhere in the south, and families have spent decades trying to find their loved ones and their grave sites. And there was one woman the other day, a 50-year-old, who finally, or after 50 years, found her daughter's grave site in the south. When I just returned back to my hometown of Kuujjuaq, after having lived in Nunavut for 15 years, there were 3 suicides and 2 attempts in a very short period of time. One of them was my grandnephew, my oldest brother's son. These are real issues on the ground. And again, they're not just about the wildlife, which the world has come to know better about than its people. These are about our children. They're about my children, my grandsons. And we have to understand that the history of the trauma that have left that kind of mark on a remarkable people that we are, and the health issues that we face, are diseases of despair. And but we're not only that, we can be, and we still are, a people who are truly ingenious. We still hunt every day. We still are out there just cherishing the cold and hunting and harvesting our animals so that we can continue to feed off the wonderful bounties of the Arctic, which is our organic farms out there. Our environment is our supermarket. And we continue to teach through the wisdom of our people on a daily basis the skills and life skills that they need. But one of the things recently, in closing, I was in Australia recently for a book tour, and New Zealand as well. And one of the great climatologists, Tim Flannery, I'm sure many of you have heard of him, I was on a panel with him, and he was asked, so what is it that we're lacking in this world, that we're not making a difference, that we're not necessarily addressing these issues and moving forward to make those changes that would lower the emissions and that we would have a better world for the next generations to come? And he said, what we lack is imagination. We have to start now to imagine a better world, not just for the peoples of the Arctic and the Aboriginal peoples of this country, but for all of us, and how we can make those connections even stronger. And by coming here to give this keynote, for me, are, I consider, teaching moments, which really, again, connect me to fellow Canadians and to people in the urban settings down here to hear those human stories. And I hope tonight has been one of those where perhaps you never really thought of it that way, or that perhaps you would be more curious now or interested in what role you could play, whether you're a student or a professor or any person living in this great city of Ottawa, to better understand that and putting these issues that we face in the Arctic in a context that makes it a larger context for all of us as a common humanity. So I thank you all again, and to the university and to Alex Trebek, for making this happen. And for that voice and the voicing to continue from the far north to you. So nakomi maria bilimasi. Thank you.
Thank you.